Hi everyone, welcome to the session on the file processing and Websockets with Ballerina. So I will be first talking about the file processing capabilities of the Ballerina. So one of the things we have identified when we are designing the Ballerina programming language is that first we need to understand the actual enterprise and its usages. So what we are building here is for the next generation of the enterprise integrations. So during the initial phases, we have identified that file-based data sharing is not gone. So even though we have all sorts of different cloud-based file sharing systems, but we have seen that intensively people are using the on-premise file storages. So we thought about basically addressing that problem in a different manner, so that we provide an API to the users to integrate with cloud-based file sharing systems as well as on-premise file-based solutions. So that is one of the reasons why we have come up with a new kind of a Ballerina I/O API, which will basically abstract the capabilities of the file-based data transfers. So I will be talking about the file API in the upcoming slides. So we have identified that in a typical enterprise, there are different file formats and different file sizes. And also the users wants to stream the files if it is a huge file. So we have identified these different requirements when we are designing the file API for the Ballerina. And of course, the security related requirements. So in Ballerina, we have different levels of capabilities when it comes to accessing files. So one is we consider file I/O as part of the Ballerina I/O APIs. So in that file I/O API, we provide different levels of access to your files. So we provide the fine-grained access, like you can basically read the byte-level information of the files, or character level, or record level. So it is like we will provide you the fine-grained file access as well as coarse-grained file access, like accessing the entire file. So reading the entire file or streaming the file from one place to another place. Likewise, we have identified all these different requirements and provided APIs to access different levels of information in a file. And also we have considered the capabilities like connecting to remote file systems like FTP, SFTP, SMB, and various kinds of file-based systems in addition to the cloud storages. So if you take the Ballerina file API, so we have two levels of access to the files. So the first level is the coarse-grained level of access to the files. So like you need to open a file, you need to create a new file, or you need to see what are the available files in a particular directory. So likewise, we will provide this coarse-grained file accessing API in the Ballerina. So I will provide you an example on the existing file API. So here, if you see that we have the file path, so we have given the file path, and then by creating a file object, you can basically first open the file. So based on your requirement, you may be opening the file for reading, or you may be opening the file for writing. So you can specify what mode you want to open this file in. Then you can basically check the existence of the file if you want. Like, so we provide a function to check the existence as well. And also we provide coarse-grained capabilities like copying a file from one location to another location, or moving a file from one location to another location. So likewise, basically these APIs will provide you the capabilities to access the file information at a very high level. So it will be at the coarse-grained level. So this was the kind of functionality we have in the existing ESB product as well. So you can basically move the file around using the file connector or VFS transport. So we, when we are designing the Ballerina APIs, we haven't lost these capabilities. What we did was like we kept these capabilities as it is, and we improve it based on the experiences we got with our customer engagements. So this is the Ballerina IO API we are currently working on. So the idea here is that we have identified that there are different IO channels when it comes to a typical enterprise. So you see, when you are interacting with different systems, it may be coming through the sockets, or it may be coming through the file APIs, or it may be coming through devices. So we have abstracted these different IO channels into the byte layer. So which means we have a canonical format of byte representation for all the messages or all the data coming from these different IO channels. So then what we are going to do is like we will provide different levels of APIs. So one API is like after the byte layer, you have the characters layer. So if you need to access a file character by character, there will be an API in the Ballerina. So that is the concept of this diagram. So we will provide different levels of access to the file information through the Ballerina APIs. So likewise, after the bytes, we have the records level access to the files. And also, we are working on basically providing data I/O, character I/O, and console I/O as well, based on the requirements of the users. And also in this architecture, we are targeting to handle different record formats. For example, in a typical enterprise integration, you may be having different CSV file formats. You may be having your own binary protocols like FIX or SAP. So you can have different kinds of record formats in these files. So what we are trying to do is like, we will provide you the capability to access those records as it is. Based on your requirement, we will provide you the APIs or capabilities so that you can build your own file format to read that particular record. So with this set of APIs, absolutely we can read any type of file at these different levels. So that is one of the key concepts behind the Ballerina IO API. So right now, if you take the Ballerina 0.95 release, we have implemented the files related functionality at this layer. So if you check the Ballerina 0.95 release, you can see there are samples in the Ballerina by example website to read the content of a file at byte level, character level, and record level. So there are some examples. So currently we have completed the implementation for the file-based IO APIs. So we are working on implementing the other sockets and devices-based IO APIs as well. So as I have mentioned, like in the 0.95 release, we provide the capabilities to read a particular file byte by byte, or character by character, or record by record. So as I have mentioned, like we have the canonical byte representation, and we are currently working on implementing the console and data I/O capabilities built into the platform. So this is an example of how to read characters from a file. So you might not see the entire code, but this code is available in the Ballerina by example website. So I took the code from there. Basically, what we are doing here is like we first get the character channel, file character channel from the given file. You can specify what are the character encoding kind of things, and when you are opening the file, whether you are opening for reading or writing. And based on the character channel, basically, you can read the record out of the characters. Like as I have mentioned, like what we are doing here is we will first the byte level, we will first get the byte level access, then get the character level access, and then get the record level access. So likewise, it will be like sequentially accessing the various levels of information of a content of the file. So this sample is available in the Ballerina by example website. So I just put it here for the reference. And also you can read the file record at the record level as well. This is another example we have in the Ballerina by example website. So as future improvements, like we are working on basically support connecting with remote file systems over different protocols like FTP, SMB, SFTP. So actually we had a connector in the past, but due to these new API designs, we thought of rewriting that connector. So currently we are working on that, implementing these file-based capabilities to connect to remote systems. And also we are looking at implementing secure file transfer by supporting the encryption capabilities within the language itself. So that is one of the another important feature we have seen from our customers, like when it comes to manage file transfer and file-based capabilities. So these features will be available within the upcoming Ballerina releases. So up to now, do you guys have any questions on the file part before I move into the WebSocket support? If not, I'll move on to the WebSocket support. So basically, as I have mentioned, like when we are developing the Ballerina from scratch, we have looked at different capabilities which has been requested from us during past 10 years when we were having the WSO2 ESB and the integrator. So we identified that the file-based data transfer or data sharing is a common use case in the enterprise, as well as there are some new technologies which are coming up in the enterprises. So one of the new technologies we have identified was the WebSocket. So we have implemented the WebSocket support to the Ballerina as well. So if you guys know the WebSockets and what is the requirement of a WebSocket, so I will give you a simple introduction, like why we need WebSocket. So in modern web applications, specifically the large web applications which consumes huge amounts of data, needs a different programming model than the standard request response based programming model. So that is why the community has invented this new protocol called the WebSockets. So even though there were some mechanisms like workarounds to deal with large amounts of data handling and dual channel request response channels kind of requirements, those were like hacks which were built on top of the HTTP 1.1 API. So that is the one of the reasons why community has invented the WebSocket API. So with WebSockets, basically you will get long-lived connections. Like if you need to connect to a particular backend system for a longer time, with the WebSockets, you can basically create a long-lived connection, and the connection will be there until you want that connection to be disconnected. And also one of the major features of the WebSocket is the bidirectional messaging. Which means in the request response pattern, so when you create a connection with a backend, you will send a request. So until you get the response, you can't send any data from that connection. So it is one directional. So we call that connection as a half duplex connection. But with the WebSockets, you can create a full duplex bidirectional data channel for a communication between two systems. And also it has improved the usage of headers. Like for example, if you think about a typical HTTP communication, when you send the first message, you send a set of headers. When you send the second message also, you need to send the same set of headers. So which means so we can improve on using the usage of the headers if we basically improve that header data communication. For example, when you send a request, first request with a set of headers, for the same second request, you don't need to send the same set of headers. So with the WebSocket, it has improved the usage of headers as well, and it will improve the bandwidth usage in your typical enterprise environments. And also another thing WebSocket is capable of doing is coexist with HTTP. For example, if you have a service which is already serving the HTTP clients, you can implement the WebSocket on top of the HTTP. So then both the HTTP and WebSockets interfaces will be available for different clients. So the same service can be coexist with HTTP and WebSocket as well. So in Ballerina, so in the WebSocket, there are different set of features. So right now, we have implemented the basic WebSocket support, like you can create a WebSocket connection. Basically, you can expose a Ballerina service as a WebSocket service. So in addition to that, we provide support for different frame types in WebSocket. So in WebSocket, there's the concept of these WebSocket frames. So right now, we support the text, binary, ping, and pong frame types. So these are all internal frame types in the WebSocket specification. So we support these different frame types when it comes to WebSocket support in Ballerina. And also, we support several sub-protocols. For example, if you want to communicate a JSON message in WebSocket, you need to specify a particular sub-protocol so that the receiver knows that this is a JSON message or this is a particularly formatted message. So we support the sub-protocol capability in the WebSocket as well. And also we support the WebSocket with the SSL. So if you want to communicate with the WebSocket service on top of SSL, we support that as well. And also in Ballerina, you can define a service which will be exposed on both HTTP and WebSocket as well. So basically, you can live alongside the HTTP interface as well. So when it comes to the Ballerina level WebSocket support, we have two concepts. The first one is the WebSocket server connector, so which is like exposing a Ballerina service through WebSocket. So in a WebSocket server connector, you can basically configure the WebSocket server connector as a Ballerina service. So in a Ballerina service, there are resources. So in the concept of the WebSocket server connector, so you can define what are the base path configuration for this particular service and what is the port you are going to open for this WebSocket service, as well as you can define different logics based on the message type. For example, if you are getting a text message, what would be the business logic? So you can define different resources for different types of messages you are receiving for the WebSocket service. So the WebSocket server connector will be used to expose a Ballerina service through the WebSocket protocol. So this is a sample WebSocket server connector configuration. Like Shafreen mentioned in his talk, like we have the concept of the Ballerina service. So here you can see we have specified the configuration for this WebSocket service. There you configure the base path and the port, and then you have defined the service with the protocol as WS. WS means WebSocket. So then you give the name of that WebSocket service. And then based on different methods, you can define different resources. For example, on handshake. So when there is a connection request from a WebSocket client, you can implement the logic within the on handshake resource. So likewise, when the client is connected, it will be executed the on open resource. So this is a bit different than the standard HTTP Ballerina service, because there we bind a particular URL path for a particular resource. But here the implementation is different because these resources are invoked when these different actions happens within the WebSocket communication scenario. For example, when the client is trying to connect with the WebSocket service, it will be executing the on handshake resource. So likewise, when the connection is established, it will execute the on open resource. So when a text message is received to this particular WebSocket service, it will execute the logic you have written within the on text message resource. So likewise, it is a bit different than the standard HTTP service. So we will provide all the required methods to basically implement your business logic when it comes to WebSocket server connector. And also we have the capability of the connecting to a WebSocket backend through the WebSocket client connector. So if you have a WebSocket backend which you need to communicate from your service, you can create a WebSocket connector, and then basically on top of that connector we provide different actions, like you can send a text message, you can send a binary message, you can send a ping message or pong message kind of things. So we will provide a set of functions which you can use against this particular WebSocket client connector. So that is how you are connecting with a WebSocket backend. So we are using WebSocket client connector to basically connect with the WebSocket backend. So those are the capabilities we have in the WebSocket aspect of the Ballerina. So we have two connectors, one for the server connector and one for the client connector. So we provide the capabilities like supporting different frame types, and based on different actions, you can execute different business logic based on the requirement. So that will be it on the WebSocket. So basically you can download the Ballerina, and you can, one of the best places to start exploring Ballerina is the Ballerina by example website. So you will see all the examples which I have mentioned in this talk, like the record level access or byte level access kind of information, and you can contribute to the Ballerina using our GitHub repo. So that will be it on this presentation. If you guys have any questions on this, I can take them.
Just a question regarding the WebSocket. So let's say you build a service and you use these things. Security-wise, is there any integration plan with, let's say, the identity server, so that you can just use the policies there to secure the endpoints or whatever you expose?
So right now, like if you want to expose your service as a secured WebSocket service, like WSS, then you can configure the key stores kind of information in the configuration section. So right now, it will be a path of a particular key store kind of location. But we are working on implementing kind of a configuration registry, so that basically you can specify that path in a external location and you can refer to that. So when you are exposing that particular service as a secured WebSocket service, so that will be the future path we are going to support. But right now you can specify a given path for that file, and it will be taken into consideration when we build the WebSocket service. Any other questions? So if not, I will conclude the session. Thank you.